In one of my prior videos, I went over a broad overview of how I aced the MCAT. Since then, I've received several requests on the specifics of my study schedule and study resources. Stay tuned to learn the details. What's going on, guys? This is Jay from MedSchoolInsiders.com. There's a lot to go over, so this is going to be part one of a two-part series. First, a quick disclaimer. As you saw in my first MCAT video, I did very well on the old MCAT, not the new one. However, that being said, the details I'm going to share with you will still be useful. I've also done a fair share of research on my own to make sure that the study schedule and resources are still relevant for the new test. So first, let's get to the resources. Links to all of the items that I describe here are going to be down in the description below. First is the official AAMC materials. No matter what budget you're on, you need to buy the official AAMC materials. Use all of them, including the official guide, practice packs, and sample tests. Because these materials come from the same people who made the actual test, they will be the most representative of the real thing. The content outlines are not the most detailed, but they do cover the fundamentals. So be sure to make note of any topics that are unfamiliar or confusing, and follow up with other resources later. The questions and practice tests are best saved for the end of your study period after you've done the majority of your content review. These tests should be used leading up to the exam to get used to the style of questions and electronic exam interface, which will mimic the real deal. Now, next is the Princeton Review. Back when I took the MCAT, the Princeton Review was known for over-preparing you for the test, and for the new MCAT, this is actually no different. Although there is more detail than you need, it is not to the extent that it becomes a waste of time. If you are shooting for a top score, such as the 99th percentile, you should definitely be using Princeton Review materials. I have heard great things about the psych and social sciences book from the Princeton Review as well. As for the practice tests, they are good but not perfect. Again, make sure you save the AAMC practice tests for the end. Use the Princeton Review practice tests earlier on. They are generally heavier on content and weaker on interpretation and critical thinking. Therefore, they are more difficult than the real deal. When it comes to predicting your score, rely on the AAMC practice test to get the idea, not the Princeton Review practice tests. Now here's the thing, I actually enrolled in the Princeton Review MCAT course, which was a little bit over $2,000. It was very expensive, and in hindsight, I'm not sure if it was necessary, but it really depends on you as the person. So I'm disciplined enough now that I can create a study schedule and try my best to stick with it, but I wasn't nearly as disciplined in college. If you don't want to do the MCAT Ultimate course, you can always do the self-paced class instead, which is a few hundred dollars cheaper and gives you the same content and instruction online versus in person. I think the most important thing is actually the Princeton Review textbooks. So if you are okay with being a little over-prepared for the test, be sure to at least get the books if you decide against the course. You can find the link to the books and the course in the description below. Now the course is secondary and it comes down to whether you 1. Like the schedule and structure of being in a class setting and 2. Benefit from learning from lectures and asking questions versus reading straight from a textbook. It was helpful for me, but I cannot say I would recommend it for everyone, especially at the price point. Next is Kaplan. You should either be using this or the Princeton Review. You do not need to use both, although some people do choose to. While the Princeton Review is helpful for achieving a 99th percentile score by over-preparing you to a certain degree, I believe Kaplan Resources will increase your score quicker, but you will reach a plateau faster as well. It's still possible to get a great score, but it will be less likely for you to get that 99th percentile. And for some people, that's totally fine. Not everyone wants to dedicate the time and effort needed to achieve a 99th percentile score. I know a few people who did the Kaplan course and they got good scores. You can still do very well by using Kaplan course or their textbooks over the Princeton Review. Just know that you're less likely to get a top score if you do so. Next is the ExamKrackers 101 verbal book, which was extremely useful for me when I took my test, and people taking the new MCAT also state that it is a great resource. I recommend that you do a couple passages every day to get used to the verbal questioning style and build your reading comprehension abilities. Unlike the science content, you cannot just sit down and consume large quantities of information. Instead, you have to carefully practice and understand the patterns of the verbal section over time. And last is the Khan Academy. The reason I love the Khan Academy is that it's a free resource. When you're confused about a concept, a quick search on Khan Academy can help clarify your confusion. However, be careful that some areas don't have enough detail while other areas are too detailed. Therefore, don't emphasize this resource too much. You should only use it sparingly when confused about a topic. So So that is the end of part one. Check out part two for a more detailed look at a study schedule incorporating these resources.